out a call for people to clean hack sites. And I was like, ooh, I want to see if it's on hack sites. So I said 20 hours, that's all I can handle. I got other stuff to do. And then it was 30 hours. And then it was 40 and 50. And they were like, hey, you want a job? I hadn't had a job in, I think Clinton's were not the last time I had an actual job because I was doing entrepreneurial types of things. But this job has been crazy. And I often am like this dog looking at malware, crazy things that happen on hack sites, and it's always changing. So you don't want to look like this dog. You don't want to have the trauma of having a hack site. So I'm going to tell you about some of the things I've seen on hack sites so that you don't have to go through the trauma of dealing with hack sites, especially a WooCommerce site, which is probably important to secure. So WordPress is under attack. Your WordPress site right now, as you're sitting here, probably has a bot poking at it. This graph here was taken from a WordFence installation, and this is what's happening on the internet as a whole. We're on about 3 million websites. The WordFence network, when I first started working with them, it would cover about a million sites at any, or a million attacks at any given time. Now we're seeing it trending upward. In the last 30 days, we have blocked bots from over 100,000 different unique IP addresses, and we've blocked over 4 billion attacks, and it's just growing. Why? Why are these hackers after WordPress? WordPress is on a third, basically powering a third of the internet. It's a big target. And hackers understand economies of scale. It's much easier for them, believe it or not, to write bot scripts that go after WordPress websites, smaller businesses' WordPress websites, than it is for them to go after, say, Amazon.com, who has a security team and is watching network traffic all the time. They expect you to not have security knowledge. They expect you not to have security acumen and the ability to block their attacks. So they go where those economies of scale are. When you're dealing with commerce, there's something called PCI. Is there anybody here who doesn't know what PCI stands for? So this is the payment card industry. So these are the people who are all together, you know, like Visa and MasterCard. They are the payment card industry. And if you are taking credit card numbers or doing any kind of commerce that deals with their property of credit cards that they've issued to their customers, they have a data security standard, and they would like you to follow that standard. They want you to keep their card members' data secure. So they have various rules in place that they would like you to follow. This doesn't matter if you're doing this online or if you have a brick and mortar store and you're taking credit cards, or perhaps you have an online store. No matter how you are taking credit cards, they want you to follow certain standards. So we are going to take a look at those standards and see how those apply to WooCommerce, see how they apply to WordPress, take all of this information and all of this experience I've had with cleaning up hacked sites, take that information and kind of merge those things together. So I'm going to walk you through those standards and what they say they want you to do. And now they have requirements that if you're doing like millions of transactions, you have to go through security scans and you have to do a self-assessment questionnaire. If you're doing less than 20,000 transactions and say you're only like using PayPal, these are things that are more like voluntary, but it's good to know. And these are good standards to keep in mind for the security of your WooCommerce sites, because these will help you start thinking about security in a different way. So we're gonna look at what they're saying and how that applies. So the first thing that they want you to do is to install and maintain a firewall configuration to protect cardholder data. Does anybody here know what a firewall is? So we have a few people who know what a firewall is. Okay, a firewall is basically an apparatus or a software that is sitting in front of your website that is filtering inbound traffic and looking for patterns that look malicious. There are different types of firewalls. Your hosting provider, probably has a network-based firewall that is filtering traffic and looking at malicious activity and blocking it. You can also have a cloud-based firewall. Now, there's an application-level firewall that can be either cloud-based or endpoint. I am throwing a lot at you. But what basically happens is there's a couple of services called Cloudflare and Security, and they have these cloud-based firewalls that you basically send network traffic to another location. They filter it. They take a look at it. They decrypt it if it's already encrypted, take a look at that information, see if it's safe. If it is, pass it on to your server. An endpoint firewall is actually integrated with your application, and it's filtering the traffic within your application. We advocate that you use an endpoint firewall, and WordFence and Ninja Firewall are application endpoint firewalls that are integrated with your WordPress site. We recommend those because they can't be bypassed. A cloud-based firewall can be bypassed. But you can use both. And you can have your hosting provider with a firewall and still have an application firewall as well. Next, they say that you should use secure passwords. Has anybody here ever used the same password everywhere? We all used to. Remember the good old days when you could just have one password for everything? We can't do that anymore because you used a password on a site like myreallyuniqueshoes.com and they got hacked, and so all of that personally identifiable information and your password ended up in a dump. And now hackers take those dumps that end up on torrents and on the dark web, big scary place, and they take those and they put them into their bots and they start poking and do what they call credential stuffing attacks. So if you have a password that is on one site that you used for one site and it ends up in a data breach and a data dump, hackers find those and they start reusing them elsewhere. We actually have cleaned numerous sites. For example, if you have a site and you log into or you have a user account with your email address that's also your domain address, they'll say, oh, well, you know, DaveRyan.io. And so let's go try this password that we found in this data dump on DaveRyan.io and go to Dave's site and see if that password is reused and get into his WordPress installation on the site. So really important to use unique passwords everywhere. I can't tell you how many sites I've cleaned where I've gotten a cPanel password that's the same as the FTP password, which is the same as the WP admin password. So what do you think happens if that site has a vulnerability in a plugin and they go into WP admin and say, oh, well, here's, you know, cutedog.123 is the password, and then they go try that on the cPanel and boom. Not only are they into the WordPress site, they're into email and everything else. Even your WordPress database password has to be strong. These are hard to remember. Use password managers. Passwords are kind of broken right now. There's new technologies that are coming that are going to make passwords and authentication much easier. But right now, use password managers like 1Pass is really good, LastPass, and just use long, complicated, no dictionary words passwords everywhere. Here's a tough one. Protect stored cardholder data. This is rule number 3 for PCI. Cardholder data is much more, I mean, they're obviously concerned with the credit card number, expiration date, the cardholder name, that security code on the back. All of that stuff should never be stored. And WooCommerce doesn't store this, but what WooCommerce does store is your customer's name, which is also considered personally identifiable information. Your customer's email address is personally identifiable information. Where your customer's billing address, where they want something shipped, that's all identifiable. Even your customer's IP address is considered by courts of law to be personally identifiable information. All of this needs to be treated with the same type of respect as if it is cardholder data. Because, and it's not just for PCI compliance, but if you're doing any business whatsoever in the EU, they have a standard called GDPR. Has anybody heard of GDPR?
Oh, yeah.
real easy way to encrypt information in a WordPress database because you have to have the encryption key on the site so that it can be decrypted and be useful. Passwords are hashed, so they are protected, but we need to make sure with using other rules and other standards to make sure that your cardholder data above and beyond that just that card number is protected. Transmission encryption. Encrypt transmission of cardholder data across open public networks. Is there anyone who does not know what a secure, what an SSL certificate is? Everybody knows the difference between HTTP and HTTPS? Okay, so that's just encrypting the connection between the browser, your customer, who's on your website, that connection, making sure that's encrypted. Remember those cloud-based firewalls? How do you think they tell if something is malicious or not, if that connection is encrypted? They actually have to break encryption in order to detect what's going on there. So something to consider. If you are going through a PCI self-assessment questionnaire and they're asking about, you know, encrypting the connection between your customer's browser and your web server, and you're using a cloud-based firewall, you need to be aware that cloud-based firewalls, in order to be a firewall, have to decrypt that connection because it's not integrated on the site. You want to make sure anything that's happening on your server and any connection where you're connecting to your server, that's encrypted. So that means that your WordPress address under your site settings, so if you go under site settings for WordPress itself, under general settings, there are two places where you want to make sure that it says HTTPS and it doesn't just say HTTP. So you'll go in there and make sure that you're using HTTPS. WooCommerce, I think, yells at you now if you have anything going on that's not HTTPS. If you're using older versions for whatever reason, which, you know, obviously we wouldn't recommend, but if you're using an older version, you may need to go in and find the setting that says force secure checkout in WooCommerce, but I think that's hidden now if you have HTTPS set up correctly. It won't yell at you and you don't have to go check that. PHP 7 is the recommended version. You may have to ask your hosting provider to make sure that you're using PHP 7.3 is what's recommended for WordPress right now. That has greater encryption standards than older versions of PHP like PHP 5, 5.6, 5.2, which are also end of life. So for security's sake, use PHP 7. It also makes your site faster. Using an SSL certificate is also beneficial for your SEO. Google does favor sites that have HTTPS. And also, if you are using FTP, does everybody use FTP? Who uses FTP for their sites? Okay. Make sure you're using SFTP. FTP is inherently insecure and is plain text. You can use different kinds of TLS connections, but if your hosting provider allows for SFTP and you're using FTP, use the SFTP. It's more secure. And if you're not using FTP, turn it off. Antivirus. Scan your servers on your servers. Don't use a remote scanning tool because that's only going to look at the front end of your site. It's going to look at what's being displayed publicly. It's not going to actually go looking at your uploads directory and dig down deep and see if there's a backdoor under, you know, 2017/8 and see if there's a backdoor somehow hidden in there. So you want an on-site scanner, not a remote scanner. And then also make sure that you are scanning your PC that connects to your WooCommerce site. I actually cleaned a site once that had FTP logs, which is oftentimes rare, but in the FTP logs we saw the same transmission happening on FTP that matched the file dates of the malware we found. And then we saw the IP address that was transmitting that malware, and it was like, oh my God, it's in the house, you know? It was the site owner's computer that had FTP and had saved their FTP password in FileZilla, and somebody had gotten into that computer using a remote desktop connection and actually put the malware on the site that way. So make sure whatever is connecting to your server has to be secure. All right, now we're going to get into the nitty-gritty. Number six is secure systems and applications. You want to develop and maintain secure systems and applications. Update everything. Now, obviously, when you get a new version of WooCommerce and it's like, oh, they're changing all the database tables, this is like, you know, you're going from like 3.5.9 to 3.6.0, and it's like, okay, do I really want to update yet? You can look at the developer's change log and see what exactly has changed. You can delay those big releases. But if it's a .1, there's bug fixes, and there may be security fixes within those. So make sure all your software is updated. Most of the malware we see on sites are because plugins have not been updated. So make sure your core files stay updated. Make sure that themes and plugins are updated. Firewalls basically buy you time. They will block malicious traffic, but it's still up to you to update everything. Just like, you know, if you have Windows and you've got Windows Defender, that's going to buy you time and block malicious attacks on your computer, but it's still up to you to make sure everything stays updated. It's up to your hosting provider to make sure that PHP and MySQL get patched. If you're using PHP MyAdmin, making sure that that is updated, and also connecting to that using a secure certificate as well. Anything that's connected to your computer, connecting to your site, needs to be HTTPS. All right. Don't tune out here because this is the most important part of this talk. Dun, dun, dun. Functional isolation of your site. That sounds, this is the one that my husband's like, what the hell does that mean? But it's the most important slide here. All right. How many plugins are in the WordPress repository right now? Any ideas?
About 50,000
and some change. You can plug a ton of stuff into WordPress, right?
Too much.
All right, so my husband gets mad at me because I make his commerce site different than everything. You know, his blog has to be somewhere else. His commerce site is a separate install of WordPress, a separate install altogether. Commerce is over here isolated. And he's like, well, why do I have to do everything twice? Commerce is isolated. It's isolated by function, and it's isolated by the amount of plugins you're putting into it. If you have a membership site, that's also a part of your business. If you have a mailing list and using, you know, MailPoet or whatever plugin to do that, put that someplace else. Whatever's on your WooCommerce site is related to taking credit card information and serving up products and services for your customers. Isolate your WooCommerce installation. Isolate your commerce away from everything else. Who here uses a cPanel? How many sites you got in your cPanel?
One each.
Get this man a prize. One each, please. All right, so here's horror story. Site cleaning comes in. It's one site that needs to be cleaned. I go and I look, and there's 35 sites in the cPanel. And every single one of them is infected. They all have, every single JavaScript file in the entire hosting account has a malicious redirect appended to the JavaScript. So no matter which of those 30, it was an agency guy down in Brazil, and he had all these sites in his cPanel. Every single one of his customer sites was redirecting to a malicious part of the internet. It was easy enough for us to clean, but he had to pay us to clean every single one of those sites. It was a mess. What ended up happening, he had one customer who had a WP admin, logged in, that password had been breached, saw a hacker logged in, went to the 404 page for that theme, and rewrote that 404 page so that it was a backdoor, and then boom, did a script that basically wrote an append to every JavaScript file, all of them redirected. If something bad happens, you want to isolate it. If something bad happens to your membership site that's also a part of your business, you want it to happen over there. You don't want your commerce site to be affected. You want to make sure that anything that's happening with WooCommerce is isolated. Remove all of the plugins and themes that you're not using. You know, some hosting providers will say, here's all the themes in the world, try them all out. You don't need them. Once you're launched, You need your one theme, and you need the plugins that are serving a purpose. If you deactivate a plugin, it can still have a vulnerability discovered at some point. It's code that you have to maintain. So make sure anything you're not using is not in your site. If you set up a test site, like tests or a staging site, or you just want to test one thing, you still have to maintain that. Don't set it up in your cPanel, oh, I'm just going to test this out, and then run off and do something else and think, well, I'm done testing that. I don't need to take care of it. You still need to take care of it. That's the most important slide. Functionally isolate your WooCommerce. And these will go a little faster. Restrict access to cardholder data. So if somebody doesn't need to know the cardholder information, if it's somebody in marketing and they're just posting blog posts, isolate them as an editor. They don't need to have access to your bank accounts. They don't need to have access to the full WP admin. Set them up a separate account and isolate. Also, assign unique IDs. If somebody says, so-and-so needs an admin account for the WordPress install, do they really? Do they really need to have admin access? And don't just have one admin account, you know, well, here's the WordPress login, and everybody shares the same login. You want to have separate logins for each person. That way you can tell if somebody does have their password breached for some reason, you know who it is and who caused this problem, so you can, like, shame them. You also want to look at two-factor authentication. Is there anybody here who uses two-factor? Okay. Who's using SMS two-factor?
Yeah.
SMS two-factor is like a horror story lately. They're having these SIM port attacks, which is a whole presentation in and of itself, but use authenticator-based two-factor authentication. And there are tons of free plugins that are available. WordFence just launched a standalone plugin, and it is also part of the newest version of WordFence has two-factor authentication as part of the free plugin. So you have no excuses. Use two-factor authentication and get everybody up on using the time-based one-time password. Nine is making sure that physical access is restricted. That's your hosting provider. Just make sure that they're PCI compliant. You can ask your hosting provider if they're PCI compliant. And if they are, they have restrictions to the data center. Now, if you download your customer's data to your hard drive, you now have a new problem, because now, in order to be PCI compliant, you have to, wherever your computer is, you have to make sure that that is physically secure as well. And that falls under the umbrella, according to the PCI guys, that falls under their umbrella of security. So if you can help it, don't download your customer data, and prevent, if you have VAs or assistants or anybody else who's working on your site, prevent them from downloading data off your website as well. Logging access, track and monitor all access to network resources and cardholder data. So there are a number of ways that your hosting provider gives you, most hosting providers will give you logs. Apache raw access logs. They should also give you FTP logs to show, so you can see who's logging in via FTP, and also cPanel hosting logs. So if you do have a breach, you can tell what happened, when it happened, and hopefully how it happened as well. Lately, we've been seeing hackers come in to cPanels and wipe out access logs. Any idea why they might do that? I bet you know. Cover in their tracks, that's it. They want to cover up what they're up to. So we've been seeing that happen, some larger scale attacks where they're just wiping out logs. So copy your logs periodically off of the server. Now those have IP addresses in it. That's considered personally identifiable information, unfortunately. So you have to care for that, according to PCI guys. And take care of those. So you want to log.
So wait a minute. So don't copy the customer identifiable information, but do copy the logs that also.
Well, where are you copying them to? You don't want to copy them to your hard drive, because then you have to secure that.
I
But if you have a hosting account set up that is in a PCI facility, you know, accredited facility, compliant facility, copy them to a different server so that if something does happen to your server, you still have access logs. And periodically copy them over so that if anything happens, you have logs that cannot be tampered with. So you can copy stuff, but you have to be aware of where you're copying things to. And now this is, you know, obviously, this is the highest standards. This is what the credit card guys want you to do. You're going to have to make decisions what's best for your business. But if you are going for PCI compliance, if you're getting into the millions of transactions, or I think it's over 20,000 transactions, they start looking at you with much more scrutiny. These are things to be aware of to prepare yourself for growth. What's that?
So they get closer to you than your proctologist.
Exactly, closer to you than your proctologist.
Are you going to put your little adult patient there?
Yes, there we go.
Security is a weird thing. I can't even tell, you know, I mean, the first security class I ever took, a guy said, if you want a completely secure computer, disconnect it from the internet, encase it in cement, and bury it 6 feet underground. How much can you use that computer? So there's obviously, you know, as security goes up, usability drops off. So it's a balance between usability, can you get your job done, or is it completely secure? So you want to have a layered security approach so that if somebody gets into one thing, they can't get into other things. They can't get into other things and escalate things up. All right, so if you're testing for these types of things, you should find out where your security vulnerabilities lie. Penetration testing, nobody wants to do that, but this is what they want you to do. Security audits are a really great way to just check on how things are in the eyes of somebody who is a neurotic security freak like me and my cohorts. We have at WordPress, $179 gives you a security audit, and we actually like go over 60 something elements of your WordPress or WooCommerce site and tell you where you're failing. And where you're failing is just where you need some improvement. It's not like a judgment, it's just giving you ideas for improvement. And there's plenty of security people and developers where you just say, hey, and you can even go on the WordPress site and look at one of our sample security audits, and it'll walk you through everything that we're looking at and why. So it'll say, you know, are there extra themes and plugins on the site? That's a failure. So you can actually take those reports and actually go through the same thing our security analysts do. Vulnerability scanning, that's something that WordPress can help you with too. The free plugin will look at every plugin and theme on your site and tell you if it has a vulnerability or not, or if it has been abandoned by the developer. Because if it hasn't been taken care of by the developer, the probability of it having problems now or in the future is much higher. So they want you to do these types of tests annually and after any changes. Do it when it feels good. When you're scared, when you're launching a new product, it's always good to have somebody take a look at it and see if there's anything that looks like a concern. Especially if you're launching something and you've got like a test site and it's in the same space, in the same cPanel. That's something a security analyst will say, whoa, what's going on here? So those types of things, things that you normally might not see. Finally, number 12, maintain a policy that addresses information security. This is just like, okay, what's our way of handling all of this? And you want to update that policy when things change. If you have a new network device, you want to update the policy. You want to have a new website you're taking care of, update that policy. You want to audit what you've got. How many websites are you handling? How many network devices are on your network? You want to know what you have and how secure it is. Because it's the one thing, that one computer that's been sitting in the corner forever. It's always been there, and that's the one they get into. So you want to have a list, and you want to see how secure it is. Audit for your software as well as the hardware, making sure it's up to date. And document that policy and view it with all of your employees, all of your virtual assistants, everybody who can touch your website or touch anything having to do with your business electronically, they need to know what that policy is. And finally, the thing nobody wants to talk about. Who's been in a car accident ever? What happens when you go through that car accident? How do you feel when you're right after it happens?
Shocked.
When you get hacked, same feeling. And normally, the human mind can handle, what do they say, 7 ± 2 bits of information at any one time. When you are in shock, it is one. I can handle one thing right now. That's all I can handle. And when you get hacked, or when something bad happens, or when a computer dies, you can handle one thing. It freaks you out when your business and your income go to nothing. So have a plan in place. Just like when you have an accident, it's good to have that insurance number handy so you have one thing that you can handle, and that's calling your insurance company and figuring out what you need to do next. So have a plan in place. Plan for the worst, and when the worst, God forbid, happens, you have a way of dealing with it. And you have a plan in place that you can non-emotionally walk through and make sure your business gets online as fast as possible. So plan for that worst thing and define the roles, who's supposed to do what within your organization and how things are supposed to happen. If you Google incident response plan, you can find templates that'll help you walk through all the things you need to think about. Other things to Google, hardening WordPress. Actually, I think I took blew past that or took out that slide, but if you Google hardening WordPress, there are tons of sites out there that'll tell you all kinds of different things that you can do in order to make WordPress more secure and a little less usable, unfortunately, but it's gonna help you stay secure. You have to decide, you know, what file permissions mean to you. You have to decide, you know, do I want to take the theme editor off of my site? There are tons of things that you will have to decide your business use case. That's it. To customers. You know, it is an ethical question. You know, it's interesting because this did just happen to Quest Diagnostics, and they lost, just this week, we found out that they lost $12 million records of customers that had gone to collections. And they know.
What? Can you rewind that?
Yeah. So a company called Quest Diagnostics, where you go get your lab work done when your doctor says, oh, we need some blood work, go down to Quest. So they actually, it was just in the news this week, that they lost 12 million customers' records. Their collection customer, their collection company had, that's the other thing, because there was medical information in it.
What happened?
Their collection company had a breach. Somebody hacked into their systems, downloaded 11.9 million customer records with social security numbers, personally identifiable information, and medical information. They did not disclose it to their customers. Guess how we found out about it? SEC filing. You file with the SEC if you're going public.
There should be a law that whenever somebody's breached, they have to make it public, especially if you're the victim.
So none of this is illegal. There's no law, right? We deal with e-commerce and PCI security all the time. The fact of the matter is you're supposed to self-report. What happens then is you're establishing goodwill. So once the security exposure is identified that you are it later, it's all about going to court and establishing goodwill. Did I follow the rules? Did I follow best practices? Did I self-report? If you do all these things, right, it will limit your legal responsibility and damages that will occur. $100,000 per account lost, potential fine, right? So the billions of dollars that would have been in right there, right? So essentially, it is like taxes. You self-report, right? If you don't report it, if they don't find out, who's going to know the difference? That's really hard, and that's really unethical. If they do find out, they'll take your house, they'll take your cars, whatever it is, right? Like, so you weigh that out in your own life, in your own risk tolerance, and you decide if you're going to disclose something that might cause an undue or unequal burden to the pain that it could be caused if it's exposed.
Yeah, and dealing with that.
Can't you go over the $100,000 for liability?
At some point, like, I don't know if they would get into jail time, right? For
no,
stuff
but
like that.
Class action stuff more than $100,000, according to, like, whatever the
people who lost their information is used against them. I'm just saying, you can be fined, basically, $100,000 per account, regardless if that information ever got used for fraudulent purchases.
Oh.
You're in charge of damages. So essentially, like, you're supposed to self-report. When you self-report, there's a series of actions that they make you do. One of them is, like, going on behalf of every one of those customers that are lost and buying them credit protection programs that they can participate in. So that way it monitors their credit for a year to see if anything happens to it. So you'll explain that, you'll buy them this program. And as long as you do all that, you may avoid any sort of fines. You know, period.
Right.
But you are being fined by your time and effort going into that,
right.
And you're also being fined by what your cost is for credit protection for each of these people, and just basically what you're going to go through in the scrutiny. So, I mean, it's like, it is, do you self-report or not? If you pay your taxes, you self-report. Okay? That's that.
But there's no law that says that you
Correct.
Have to.
There's no law.
It just
yes.
ends up being a civil suit, right?
No law yet.
Yet.
Oh, and then
the thing that gets me the worst is, like, things like Equifax, where I didn't give them all of my information, but they've collected it from other places.
I know, but they are grossly negligent. And during my cybersecurity meeting with the FBI and Homeland Security, you're allowed to just totally get into a huge class action lawsuit. They were grossly negligent. You know, it was like security for dummies. They left everything at default. So somebody, the head guy, right, and the ones under him did it on purpose. Nobody's that stupid to leave things on default. Nobody.
I always
They're grossly negligent.
I always
especially
Equifax. Like, somebody's just being stupid and I don't think they did it maliciously, but I think they didn't take actions that
negligent.
Yeah.
I'm just curious, they've mentioned yet, is there any law in the EU or anything like that for this?
EU, GDPR, and
okay.
I think Google was the one that got fined $50 million. That was, I just read an article recently about 1 year after GDPR went into effect. And Google was the one that got the biggest fine, but there were a number of companies that were fined, but Google was the big bulk.
And logically, they're going to go after the big ones first, so that everybody else gets the message.
Pretty much, yeah. Making an example.
There is a California data privacy law. It's been pretty much D2. It's not very effective at this point, but it's really being used as inspiration and impetus for getting a national privacy law. So even if you're not dealing with European customers, even if you don't think you'll ever deal with someone who's affected by GDPR, you should start following GDPR as soon as possible.
Yeah.
Because it will prepare you for the US law that is coming eventually.
Right. And just getting really familiar with what personally identifiable information actually is. Google it, memorize it. If you're collecting that information from anybody, just take the utmost care with it. Yeah? Say again?
Magenta?
Sorry. Magenta?
Try not to.
Try not to.
I'll leave it there.
One of our security analysts called Magento the Joomla of the e-commerce world.
Huh? So what?
Really?
What? I didn't hear
One of the geeks I work
the Joomla for CMS.
Yeah. It's an SEO plugin. Well, there's like how many SEO plugins in the repository that security researchers are poking at all the time, whereas this premium plugin that's on ThemeForest or CodeCanyon that never gets the light of day, or no security researchers are ever looking at it because they have to pay for it and they're not going to dish out money for it, and there's a vulnerability, and somebody gets into a hacked site, finds that vulnerability because now some hacker has it, and then it just kind of catches like wildfire. But that it takes so much longer for those premium products for vulnerabilities to be discovered, disclosed, and patched. So
because WordPress is so big, and companies like Facebook that has top-notch security team and hosting providers and all of these other people are looking at the source, it's much more likely that vulnerabilities are going to be patched.
Right. Totally.
That's the last slide of your info.
Oh. So I have a podcast called Think Like a Hacker. It's on YouTube, it's everywhere. WordFence/podcast, so it's kind of new. We just did episode 19. We don't know what we're doing.